Hey, this is Dr. K from iMedical School, and today we're going to talk about the electron transport chain, otherwise known as the ETC. In previous videos, we talked about glycolysis, pyruvate decarboxylation, and the citric acid cycle. Each of these steps was preparation for the electron transport chain, with the production of NADH and FADH2. The purpose of producing NADH and FADH2 was to use these electron carriers to create ATP in a process called oxidative phosphorylation. Let's begin by talking about where the electron transport chain takes place. The ETC is present in the inner mitochondrial membrane. The inner mitochondrial membrane is important because it is selectively permeable to hydrogen, sodium, and potassium. The selective permeability is vital because it allows for the creation of a hydrogen ion gradient, which is the engine for ATP production. In addition, there are folds in the inner mitochondrial membrane called cristae. Cristae increase the surface area and increase the ability to produce ATP by allowing more complexes to fit in the inner mitochondrial membrane. Now, there are four complexes involved in the ETC, with complex 5 being involved in oxidative phosphorylation. They are conveniently named complex 1, 2, 3, and 4. Unfortunately, a few of these complexes have alternate names, which I'll highlight as we go through the ETC. Remember, when we formed NADH, we represented it as NADH plus a hydrogen ion. This representation reflects the fact that there is a hybrid ion represented by the H in NADH and one hydrogen atom represented as the H+. The hybrid ion is passed as an electron from complex to complex in the ETC, while the hydrogen atom is shuttled by each of the complexes into the intermembrane space to create a hydrogen ion gradient. This gradient will later be used by oxidative phosphorylation to create ATP. NADH with H+ enters the ETC via the NADH dehydrogenase complex, otherwise known as complex 1. As the name suggests, NADH dehydrogenase removes the electrons with the hydrogen atom from NADH. NADH dehydrogenase contains a flavin mononucleotide molecule that allows for the acceptance of electrons and a hydrogen from NADH. NADH dehydrogenase shuttles the hydrogen ion from NADH into the mitochondrial intermembrane space and then passes the electrons down the ETC cycle. NADH dehydrogenase contains an iron-sulfur complex that allows transfer of electrons to coenzyme Q, which is an intermediary complex between complex 1 and complex 3. An alternate name for coenzyme Q is ubiquinone. The importance of coenzyme Q is that not only does it accept electrons from NADH dehydrogenase complex, otherwise known as complex 1, but it can also accept electrons from complex 2. Complex 2 is also called succinate dehydrogenase, or succinate ubiquinone oxyreductase. If you remember, succinate is one of the intermediate products in the citric acid cycle. Succinate dehydrogenase acts on succinate to create fumarate in the citric acid cycle. In the process, an FADH molecule is reduced to FADH2. FADH2 passes its electrons to coenzyme Q. Coenzyme Q, whether it accepts electrons from complex 1 or complex 2, passes these electrons to complex 3. Complex 3, 4, and 5 all contain a heme group. As electrons are passed from one complex to another, the ferric atom of the heme group is converted to a 2+ ferric state. As electrons pass from complex 3, otherwise known as cytochrome B and C, these electrons are transported to complex 4, otherwise known as cytochrome A and A3. Complex 4 is the only complex that interacts with oxygen. In doing so, the electrons reduce the oxygen atom to H2O, or water. This is a key point because oxygen is the final electron acceptor of the ETC to produce water. In the entire electron transport chain, electrons are passed from complex to complex, and in the meantime, each complex pushes hydrogen atoms to the intermembrane space. This is the most important point about the ETC cycle. The shuttling of hydrogen atoms into the intermembrane space creates a diffusion gradient. This gradient that is created is like stretching a rubber band in that there's a lot of energy that you're putting in. As soon as you let go of the rubber band, it will go flying because of the pent-up energy. The hydrogen gradient is the same way. In our next video, we'll talk about oxidative phosphorylation, which is a process where the gradient will be relieved, creating a large amount of ATP. As a side note, realize there are many chemicals that can inhibit the ETC due to the interaction with the cytochromes involved. For example, antimycin A is a product produced by some fungi that can actually inhibit the transport of electrons from cytochrome B to cytochrome C within the complex 3. In addition, cyanide and carbon monoxide prevent the final transfer of electrons to oxygen. If this occurs, electrons build up in the complex, disrupting the gradient and disrupt the ETC cycle. Well, that was a brief review of the electron transport chain system. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, make sure to share this video with your friends on Facebook, Google Plus, and Twitter. You can follow us on Facebook and Google Plus at iMedicalSchool and Twitter at iMedSchool. Make sure to like, share, comment, and subscribe. This is Dr. K, and I'll see you next time.